Where are you going, Holmes? Have you been invited somewhere?
We have been invited, Watson.
We have? Where to?
To the Baker Street Irregulars annual dinner. They sent us an invitation. It is on the table.
A dinner? How could those street urchins afford anything like that? I can't understand your interest in them, Holmes. They're dirty. They wouldn't hesitate to steal your wallet. They...
Watson, you should be excited. It is a secret dinner. Its location changes every year. Read the menu. Sounds mouth-watering.
All right. We, the secret police of Baker Street, invite you, Sherlock Holmes, and Dr. Watson to our annual dinner. Menu, entree, frozen rathead salad. Is this a joke?
Not at all. Pray continue.
Main course, sow's udder in Danny Nutcracker's way. Ah, sounds disgusting, Holmes. Hedgehog goulash. Street turnips in homemade juice. And it goes on.
Ah, I can hear them on the stairs now.
Well, we can't go there. We can't eat that.
Watson, you'll hurt the feelings of those poor children. We have to go.
Oh, Mr. Holmes.
It is fine, Mrs. Hudson.
Mr. Holmes.
Wiggins, Dr. Watson is getting ready. He will be delighted to join us. You don't look well, my young man. Is there something wrong? Don't tell me the dinner is cancelled.
Mr. Holmes is my brother, Leighton. He's in a prison cell. They say he's killed two men. You have to help us, Mr. Holmes, because I know he didn't do it.
Where is he now?
From what I've heard, they took him to the yard and they gave him a good beating already. You know what they're like. They'll hang him. They won't look any further.
Holmes, we have to help him.
Well, and forget about the dinner. Wiggins, I'll take the case.
You're fantastic, Mr. Holmes. I'll be waiting for you at the crime scene. You'll be there, right? It's on Half Moon Street in Whitechapel.
Very well.
So it's time to start solving the last case in the game. And this case is called a Half Moon Walk. Watson is an expert in moonwalking. During this game, he's done a lot of that. And I think it's interesting how he's so willing to help Wiggins now, when just a while ago he was calling him a street urchin and saying that he wouldn't hesitate to steal his wallet. So nice change of opinion there, Watson. But oh well. Let's get on with the case.
Holmes, poor little Wiggins needs our help.
Yeah, well, a while ago you were saying poor little Wiggins could steal your wallet and that he was filthy and dirty, so... Nice change of opinion, Watson. Very nice indeed. So here we have our crime scene. There are two dead bodies, apparently. Let's inspect.
Please, gentlemen, leave the scene now. Oh, Mr. Holmes, is that you?
Good evening, Constable...
Constable Marrow. I was here with Inspector Abeline during the Ripper case, Mr. Holmes.
Case I'd like to solve.
But then this is nothing like that case. With this one, we've got the murderer, the weapon, and the statements, which speak for themselves.
Of course, Marrow. But you know that appearances can sometimes be deceiving. Who were the victims?
The two men here, both shot. The stabbed fellow was Brian Facotti, a well-known ruffian. The other, Kenneth Butler, a jeweler by trade.
You spoke of statements. You have witnesses?
Well, I was there, so I gave my own statement. And then there were two other witnesses who said they saw the killer Chapman. Mr. Turner, a gentleman who lives in that flat over there. And Polly Powell, a flower seller, who was over at the far side of the street.
So, Constable Marrow, I should be delighted to hear your testimony.
I was standing at the north side of Half Moon Street. That was the side that you came from.
But you would have been unable to observe this part of the street, where we are standing now.
That is correct. But I saw the two victims slowly enter Half Moon Street, and then shortly after, the fireworks started. A few minutes after that, the fellow Chapman rushed towards me and ran into Half Moon Street.
Please continue.
I didn't pay attention, but suddenly I heard a woman's cries and police whistles on the other side of Half Moon Street. I rushed over there and I saw the two dead bodies on the ground. When I reached Whitechapel Street, I saw Leighton Chapman. He'd been caught by two police constables.
Did you hear the shots?
I didn't hear any shots. The fireworks were all over the sky. They were so loud, I couldn't hear anything else.
That's quite convenient.
What were the fireworks in honor of, Constable?
Well, today's Queen Victoria's birthday, Mr.
And we
Holmes.
Should care why?
Yes, I appear to have lost track of the days. It is May now, of course. Constable Marrow, what else caught your attention while you were running through Half Moon Street?
I saw nothing but rats, and I took the time to light every corner with my lamp.
Did you happen to look up at Mr. Turner's window when you were on Half Moon Street at that time?
Yes, I saw that the window was open, but no one was there. It was dark in the room.
Constable, your statements have been of great value to me.
Okay, so next up we're going to take a look at the dead bodies. Man, this guy's got an agony expression.
A fairly long pole with a forked end.
It seems that he died in pain. Let's see.
He tried to stop the bleeding with his hand. Death was not instant. The bullet penetrated his stomach, a dreadful wound.
So yeah, he probably agonized to death because...
A tattoo from Westgate Prison. Vicotti must have done some time there.
He didn't have instant death for sure, and his facial expression reveals a lot of pain.
Brian Vicotti suffered greatly. What a terrible way to die.
Indeed. Okay, well, let's look at the other body now. He was shot in the head, so he died immediately. We got something here, though. Piece of wood.
A piece of wood that has stuck between the cobblestones. Let us take a closer look.
I have no idea where that's from.
This shard of wood is quite new.
But we'll keep it as evidence.
The bullet struck his head. This man didn't stand a chance.
Let's see, what else do we have here? A key.
This is an ordinary key. I wonder what kind of door it opens.
Okay, so we examined the two bodies. Now we're going to talk with the people who said they saw the murder. So let's talk with this man first, Ryan Turner.
Good evening, Mr. Turner.
I heard Constable Marrow reply to you as Mr. Holmes. Are you that detective, gentlemen? I've heard of you. And, well, I know things. Things about this evening.
Excellent. Might we hear your story? Could you tell us everything that you may have seen or heard?
I was already in bed when the fireworks started. A few moments after... I clearly heard two gunshots from outside.
Please continue.
I quickly got up and I grabbed the lamp from my nightstand and I rushed towards the window. I looked down and I saw two bodies. And there was a man with a gun who was standing nearby.
Where exactly?
Well, near this body.
Did he notice you?
I don't think so. He rushed towards Whitechapel Street without looking around.
If I didn't know any better, I'd say that they shot each other.
Did you see anyone else in the street?
No, I saw no one but that man, the murderer, the fellow they caught.
Were the two shots you heard consecutive?
Yes, there was a very short pause between them, and they sounded different somehow. It seemed to me that the second shot was louder than the first.
That is an interesting comment. Mr. Turner, what were your actions after you stepped up to the window?
I was afraid that the man with a gun might return, so I stayed close to the window till I saw the policeman coming in the half moon from Whitechapel. Then I walked out to tell them everything I saw.
That's a contradiction based on what the constable told us, because he said there wasn't anyone by the window when he arrived, so this guy's probably lying. But like I said, it almost seems like the two victims almost could have shot each other. I know it's far too early to make any deductions, but it doesn't seem that unlikely.
You have helped us a great deal, Mr. Turner.
Okay, we can make a deduction here. Turner's view, he said that he remained by the window, but that doesn't seem to be to make sense considering Constable Merrill said that there was nobody by the window. So one of them is lying, and I'd probably say, yeah, there's conflicting statements right here. One of them is not telling the truth, and I would imagine that the person who isn't being truthful right now is Mr. Turner. So we'll come to talk with him in a little bit, but first let's talk with the flower lady. But I'm just imagining that the dude who got shot in the head could have shot the other guy in the stomach first, and then the guy who got shot in the stomach shot the other dude in the head.
Mrs. Howell?
Possibly.
What do you want?
My name is Sherlock Holmes. I'm assisting the police with their investigation of the crime that took place this evening.
Well, I've already gave my testimony, but very well.
Could you tell us everything that you may have seen or heard?
Yes. I was selling my flowers as usual, and then the fireworks began in honor of Queen Victoria. I enjoyed those. But then, all of a sudden, a young lad ran out of Half Moon Street and stopped just by me. He had a gun in his hand. He was like a ghost and all covered in blood. It was dark, but I could see him because of the flashes from the fireworks.
And then?
I screamed as loud as I could. I knew that a policeman should be on duty in the vicinity. He had no time to escape. Two constables got him. Then another constable came out from the very same street, and I heard him talking of a horrible murder.
Mrs. Powell, did you hear the gunshots?
I'm not sure. You know, what with the fireworks?
Did you see anyone else leaving Half Moon Street prior to or at the time of the crime?
No, sir, I did not. Even with all the fireworks, I was very attentive, as I'm always on the lookout for customers.
My thanks to you, Mrs. Powell.
Yeah, maybe we should buy some flowers from...
This mirror is turned towards Half Moon Street.
Well, that's interesting. I don't think they just placed the mirror here just for no good reason, but we'll see. It just occurred to me that the woman we just talked to, Polly Powell, her face really reminds me of Lady Brackenstall, just a little bit more dirty and, well, without the bruises and all. You know, Lady Brackenstall, the woman from the fourth case?
I'll do anything to save my brother, Mr. Holmes.
I wonder if they use the same face model. But we're going to confront Mr. Turner now, due to the contradictions of the statement.
Mr. Turner, you have stated that you remained close by your window after the crime, is that correct?
Oh, yes, Mr. Holmes. I stayed at my window until the policeman arrived to examine the dead bodies.
Nope, we know that's not true. Let's select Turner's contradiction. Because the police says there was nobody by the window.
That is very interesting, Mr. Turner. Constable Marrow stated that he did not see anyone at the window when he was running through Half Moon Street.
I think Constable Marrow and me, we might have been distracted by the whistles and shouts coming from Whitechapel. We could have missed each other somehow. You understand what I mean? It was a bit of a stressful moment, to tell you the truth, sir.
Allow me to form my own theories, Mr. Turner. Would you mind showing me the view that you had from your window?
Not at all, Mr. Holmes. Please, follow me.
I shall. Oh, he's got a limp. Pretty bad one.
Mr. Turner appears to live very modestly.
Okay, so let's start inspecting his house.
This fire is dying out. It was last tended to over an hour ago.
Can use our special view here. Fire, ashes, and a piece of burnt paper.
The papers are almost entirely burned. I am unable to see what's written here.
Yeah, but it looks like pages from a book or
These words are illegible. The papers were thrown into the fire just a short while ago.
On the lookout. Newspaper, nothing special. Let's check the bookshelves.
The books on this shelf are in a mess. It looks as though Mr. Turner was trying to find something in a hurry here a short while ago.
There's a cane. It's broken. I wonder if the piece of wood that we found matches. It might.
This walking stick is broken. It was placed here quite recently. A perfect match. So, Mr. Turner broke his stick when it became stuck between the cobblestones. He did not mention that he was so near to the victims.
That's rather interesting. So his testimony is false. So we'll need to question him about that.
Mr. Turner was roused from his bed by the sound of gunshots.
So let's take a look at the window. Because he's clearly lying. But I don't think he's the culprit at all.
This kitchen knife is quite sharp.
Can use special view again. Kitchen table, sweepings, shredded paper. Possibly the paper that he threw into the fireplace.
There are pieces of shredded paper scattered over the table. This kitchen knife was used to cut the paper.
Interesting. So he's hiding something, that's for sure. I wonder if he stole money from the victims or something of that nature.
So, that's the view Mr. Turner had when he opened the window.
Well, there's Watson.
Brian Vercotti's contorted corpse.
Useless as always.
The dead body of Kenneth Butler. Mr. Turner had a perfect view of the crime scene. He saw the bodies clearly, and Leighton Chapman standing over them.
Okay, so I guess we have to use our imagination to determine the sequence of events based on the details that we've gathered. So the first one would be Mr. Turner got out of bed after he heard the gunshots and picked up his cane. Now here he's placing his stick, so it can't be right now. Throwing it stuff into the fire has to be the last thing. Cutting pieces of paper, no. The second thing would have to be he would walk towards the window and open the window. And the third thing would be the fact that he's the thing that he's been lying about, and that's the fact that he approached the body. Then he would have placed the broken stick, cut the piece of paper, and finally threw the pieces of paper into the fireplace. So that seems to be the correct sequence of events, but let's watch. And by the way, I don't want you guys to think that I have anything against Dr. Watson or anything. It's just that, well, in this game, I think that Watson's role is really more of a comic relief character. I mean, he does help out a little bit, but for the most part, I think he acts rather clueless. We're just tracing these steps of Mr. Turner. You can speed up by pressing X. So, you know, it's kind of like he follows Sherlock around, but he doesn't really add that much to the solution, or he hasn't had a lot to the solution of each case so far. He served as a gunman and he also took a bottle of poison from Miss White's hand in the previous case, but that's really the only things that are really relevant that he did in this game. Like I said, I think Toby, the dog, was more helpful to us than Watson. But like I said, I actually think his character is kind of funny. He just wasn't super useful in these cases. But maybe he'll redeem himself with this last case, who knows.
So Mr. Turner used a book to hide an object that he found on Kenneth Butler's body. The question is, what did he find?
Well, he certainly stole something. We can check at the stand. Fat prints. Ugh. He should wash his hand.
I can see prints from greasy fingers upon the cover of this book. Let us take a closer look.
God, he should really wash his hands. Let's take... a bracelet.
Well now, what a find. A precious jewel concealed inside a book.
That makes sense. He stole it from the victim.
A bracelet with a unique ram's head design. A distinctive feature of ancient Grecian artifacts, probably of the Hellenistic era.
Well, to be fair, he's poor, so I'm not surprised that he stole... He seems to be very poor. So I'm not surprised that he stole the bracelet just to see if he could get some money out of it, but I don't think he would have been responsible for the death of either of our victims, not at all. He was just in the right place at the right time and figured there was nothing wrong with stealing the bracelet, especially since he seems to need the money. But let's question him and see what he has to say.
Mr. Turner, how would it be possible for a man of advanced years, such as yourself, to rush from his bed to the window in a matter of seconds, as you have stated?
Well, I'm able to move very quickly, despite my age. And when the situation requires it, Mr. Holmes.
I don't think so.
I highly doubt that, Mr. Turner. I observe that you suffer a severe limp due to your injured right leg. It would have taken at least 10 seconds for you to approach the window. That means you could have easily missed something or someone in Half Moon Street during that time.
You're right, Mr. Holmes. I could have missed something. But it did seem to me that everything happened so quickly. Oh, time can pull tricks on you.
Well, you have to tell us the whole truth.
What of everything else that you told us? Mr. Turner, it is vital that we have your complete and true statement.
Mr. Holmes, I do assure you that the other things I said were most sincere.
Oh yeah, what about the bracelet, man? Come on. This is Sherlock Holmes you're talking to.
Mr. Turner, you were not sincere with me. Not then, and not now.
But Mr. Holmes...
This, Mr. Turner, does not look like anything that a poor man might possess. It is worth more than the home that you live in.
I can explain.
No, merely correct me if I am wrong. You saw Leighton Chapman through the window, but you also noticed a glittering object on the ground. This... precious jewel. You walked down and took the bracelet from the body of Kenneth Butler, and when you heard the whistles, you hurried away. That broke your walking stick. It caught fast between the cobbles. Constable Marrow was unable to see you in the window as you were climbing up the stairs on your way back to your flat. Upon returning home, you hid the precious jewel inside a book.
Mr. Holmes, please don't send me to prison. I didn't do anything bad. I'm just a poor man. When I chanced upon the bracelet, I saw it as an opportunity to make a little money. I was desperate. I only took the bracelet, that's all, I swear.
You made a mistake by lying to me. But you are not a criminal. I believe that. Although I must return this bracelet to its rightful owner.
Can't we give him a little bit of money? I kind of feel bad. But it seems that the next... thing that we need to do is go to Scotland Yard to interrogate the prime suspect right now, but that's for the next segment. So thank you so much for watching. This case seems very promising. So I'll see you all later. Take care, my friends.